In this lecture, we are going to look at an experimental technique to measure velocity field in microfluidic channels, and this technique is called micro particle image velocimetry. So we have seen and considered the governing equations for fluid flow in different microfluidic channel geometries, and we have already looked at solutions to those equations. And in case you don't have analytical solutions to those equations, one can solve those equations with the boundary conditions numerically and obtain the flow field. But if you want to measure that flow field experimentally or compare your theoretical results with experimental data, then you need to obtain the velocity vectors, let's say in this geometry, in this flow field, and one would require velocity vectors from the experiments. So the way to do it is a technique called micro particle image velocimetry. So I will call this as micro PIV. So micro PIV is basically an adaptation of the macroscopic PIV technique, which was well known before this micro particle image velocimetry came into picture. And the basic principle of micro PIV and the macroscopic PIV is the same, but there are lots of differences in how you do micro PIV experiments in practice. But the basic principle is same. So in this lecture, we are just going to look at the basic principle, and in subsequent lectures, we'll see how we can adapt this PIV technique to microfluidic flows. Now the idea is that in PIV, we seed the flow with small particles. So if we have a flow field, we'll seed it with small particles such that the particles faithfully follow the flow. That means by tracking the motion of the particles, we can estimate the flow velocity at that particular point. And of course, the particles should not disrupt the flow field, and that is one of the requirements for the particles which are seeded in the flow. And for micro PIV, you should not have such high large size particles that the particles themselves clog the device. Now consider a flow field like this. Okay, and if you want to measure the velocity field throughout this channel, so we have a channel with a converging cross section, and let's assume as of now that we have steady flow, but particle image velocimetry can be used to measure both unsteady as well as steady flows. So let's say this is a steady flow where we seed the flow with relatively large number of particles, something like this. So the idea is that we observe these particles at fixed time intervals. So let's say we image this system at time t, and at next time, if we record the image, if we know exactly the time gap between the two images, we would expect that the particles would move by a small distance. So let's say this particle comes over here, this particular particle moves over here. Similarly, we will get new positions for all these particles. Now, if we look at a small region over here, so we will have a case like this where we have a small region where we had, let's say, a few particles, let's say two particles like this at time t. At the next instant, at t plus delta t, this particle might have moved over here, this particle would move here, and this particle would move here. That means if we just look at on the same image, if we overlay these two images, so we have one particle here, another particle over here, then another particle over here at time t, and at time t plus delta t, one particle is now, this particle has moved over here, this particle, let's say, moves over here, and this particle, can you can say, is over here. So if we measure the displacement of these two particles within the time step delta t, so let's say that this is x direction and this is y direction. So for every particle, let's say you measure the distance delta x and delta y that the particle has moved in time delta t, then if the particles faithfully follow the flow, then one could say that the x component of the velocity u is given as delta x over delta t, the y component is given as delta y over delta t. So if we can actually track the motion of individual particles, then we can certainly get the velocities, and we can try to capture the images at relatively short intervals so that the particles haven't moved really far, so we can get a good approximation for the derivative dx by dt, which can be written as delta x by delta t. Now, if you track individual particles, this method is called particle tracking velocimetry. Now, the problem with this is that although you can certainly do particle tracking velocimetry, one always faces this challenge that all these particles that are seeded in the flow are indistinguishable. So it might happen that because you cannot distinguish the particles, we can say that maybe this particle over here has moved to this particular location, and let's say this particle has moved to the other location. So how can we say that, you know, this particle actually is in the previous image is actually this particle? So this is one of the problems for particle tracking velocimetry. And the other issue is that you can get velocity vectors only at those locations where you have the particle. So starting from, let's say, this particle, you would draw a velocity vector only at this particular point. But often one would need velocity vectors at regular spaced intervals like this. And there is no surety that the particles would be present at this regular spacing. So therefore, it's sometimes not preferred to track the motion of individual particles. But what we can track easily is not the individual particles, but looking at the motion of the patterns of particles. That means, rather than looking at the motion of these individual particles, if we look at this pattern of particles, we can see that on average, this whole pattern has shifted towards the right in the next image, and using this, if we can estimate that how much this pattern has shifted in X and Y direction, we can obtain the velocity vectors for this region where you have this particular pattern that is moving with the flow. So what we can do for tracking the motion of these patterns is that first we can divide our images at different time intervals into regularly spaced regions, something like this. So let's say we can divide the image into this grid, and every let's say the rectangle region is called an interrogation region. So we can divide this image into interrogation regions, and in general the interrogation region can be a rectangle, and the size of this interrogation region can be chosen such that it depends upon how far you need the velocity vectors, or what is the spacing at which you need the velocity vectors. So if we can track the relative shift in the patterns of particles within this interrogation region, let's say you have a pattern like this, and at the next time instant the pattern looks something like this, then we can say that the mean flow velocity within this interrogation region is given by a particular velocity vector, which is given by u, the x component is given by delta x by delta t, and the y component is given by delta y by delta t. And we can say that this velocity vector is at the centroid of this rectangle. Now similarly, if we do this analysis for all these interrogation regions, we can get a grid of velocity vectors at the center points of all these rectangular interrogation regions. Now to estimate how much the patterns have moved in time step delta t, the basic idea is that you can take, let's say this is the interrogation region at time t, and this is the interrogation region at time t plus delta t. The basic idea is that if you take this image and overlap with this image at t plus delta t, and then you try to shift this image in x and y direction to find the best overlap between these two images, that relative shift delta x and delta y will tell you at which you will have the best overlap, will tell you how much this pattern in the particles has actually moved, and therefore you will get this delta x and delta y. Now to do it in practice, one would calculate a cross correlation between these two images. The cross correlation will tell us that how much should I shift this image in x and Y direction such that it best overlaps with this second image. Now to understand cross-correlation, let's look at a cross-correlation between one-dimensional function, because that is easier to understand. So let's look at one-dimensional cross correlation. So if you have two functions, or let's say two functions in spatial coordinate, or they can be in time series. So let's say you have two functions f of x and g of x. Then if we want to define the cross correlation, so the cross correlation is defined as f cross g is defined as f of x times g of x plus xi, and we integrate the product over x going from minus infinity to infinity. So as a result, because we have done integration over x, we'll get a function in xi. So what does this mathematical operation actually mean? To understand that, let's look at two simple functions. Let's say we have f as a function of x, which is a top hat function, and we have g as a function of x, which is a top hat function, which is slightly shifted towards the right. Now we can think of this cross correlation as an operation where you shift one of these functions, then multiply and perform a summation. So to get a better idea, let's try to transform this variable x to x minus xi, and you can see that the cross correlation can be written as minus infinity to infinity and integral f of x minus xi times g of x dx. So this is what I was talking about earlier, that what we are doing is we have this function f, okay, and f of x minus xi would mean that we have moved this function, let's say, by a distance xi. Then I multiply these two functions, the shifted f and g of x, and then I integrate and I will get a value. So in this case, these two functions are not overlapping at all, and therefore I'll get a zero value. But at a particular distance, xi, these functions will overlap and the product would be non-zero, and the integral over that will be non-zero. So if we plot this cross correlation versus the shift in function f, then we will see that you will get something like this, because when you have the best overlap between f x minus xi and with g of x, then the integral would be the maximum. Now if you look at this point of maxima, it actually tells how much g of x is shifted relative to this function f of x. So if I measure this point if I measure this peak, location of the peak in the cross correlation, it actually tells this distance, let's say delta x, which by which I have shifted this f of x to get g of x. So similarly, in the 2D cross correlation, we can extend this analysis to a 2D cross correlation, where the 2D cross correlation is defined as So instead of shifting in only one direction, we have now shifts in both directions. So we can say it is f of x comma y times g of x plus xi y plus eta dx dy, and the integration is over the whole domain. And this can also be written as f of x minus xi y minus eta times g of x comma y dx dy. That means how much should I shift this function in x and y direction such that it best overlaps with this function g of x comma y, and when you have the best overlap, then the product will have the maximum integral, that is the maximum correlation. So that is how you can do that is how you can find how much this image is shifted from this if we can take a two-dimensional cross correlation between these two images. Now so this definition of cross correlation is for continuous functions, but usually the images will have a finite number of pixels, and data is known at finite number of pixels. So let's say you have an image which is m cross n. That means you have m pixels in one direction and n pixels in the other direction. In that case, you can compute the cross correlation as, and let's say the relative shift is in terms of pixels. So instead of these integrals, we'll have summations, and we have so instead of having a double integral, we'll have summation over m and n, and we'll shift one of the images and in by k and in one direction, and l in the vertical direction, take the product of these two images and then compute this double summation. So m would go from 0 to m minus 1, and n will go from 0 to n minus 1. So by taking the cross correlation, we'll find that best distance x and y, delta x and delta y, where these two images are actually overlapping the best. So if we take these two images and you take, so if you take these two images and if you take the cross correlation, one would get a peak, one would get a peak at a particular location. So if you view this 3D this surface plot from the top, you will see that the peak, the cross correlation would have a peak at a particular value, and if you note the location of the peak, then you would find that how much is this peak shifted from the center, and that is the location, or that is by the distance delta x and delta y by which your pattern has actually moved within time delta t. So you would get u is delta x by delta t, and v is delta y over delta t. So if you repeat this process for all the interrogation regions, in the image, you can then get velocity vectors at regularly spaced intervals in x and y, because we are drawing these velocity vectors from the centroid of these interrogation regions. So you will get a grid of these velocity vectors. So this is the basic idea of micro PIV and PIV in general, and the video that you will see shows how the particles actually look like and how you can get the velocity vectors from the regularly spaced intervals, if you take images of those particles at regularly spaced intervals. Now there are lots of practical aspects that we need to discuss. That is, how can we choose those particles which can faithfully follow the flow? What kind of illumination would you need? And these are the things that will that we will discuss in the subsequent lectures. But this is the basic idea of how we can use cross correlations to get velocity vectors by taking images at regularly spaced intervals delta t.